Ve, ahí está el teacher. Ay, ahí está.
Hi. How are you?
Hi, teacher.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening, teacher. How are you today?
I'm fine, and you?
Worry, teacher.
How are things? Hi, Laura. Sonia, Dilcia. Hi, Delcy.
Todo Hi, bien. How are you? Good to see you.
Hi, good to see you too. Hi, Karen.
Good evening.
Good evening, everyone.
A ver.
Hi.
Hi, teacher.
Hi. Hi.
Good evening, teacher.
Good evening. How are you?
I'm doing fine, thanks. How are you?
I'm fine too, and ready.
Great, great.
Hi, Carlos.
Hi, Juan.
How are you?
How are you?
Long time no see, sir. You were lost.
Long time, yeah.
Hello, good evening.
Hi, good evening. Hi, Pedro.
Good evening.
Good evening. Hi. How are you?
I worry for the course.
Great, that's fine. Ceci, my friend.
Hi. How are you?
Fine.
Happy to be here.
Hello, teacher.
Hi, Mila. Hi, Maricielo.
Hi, Mr. B. How are you?
Fine, and you?
Great. Long time no see.
Hi, Julie.
Yes.
Hello, teacher. Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you, teacher?
I'm fine. And you?
Yeah, I'm fine.
In Chiclayo?
Yes, in Chiclayo.
Good.
So, I came to visit my mother.
Good.
Yes. Laura, hello.
Aquí ese evento pasó porque hoy soy la persona que soy por ese evento. semanas, el siguiente paso va a ser, ok, ya lo voy a empezar a ver con un poquito de humor. Y a lo mejor es...
All right, just unmute your microphone in case you want to say something or there's an intervention, all right? I already muted everyone right now, but you can open the microphone if you want to say something. Hi, Karina.
Hello, Juan. Nice to see you.
See you too.
Okay, thank you for the invitation.
You're welcome. Cecilia, hi. Eunice, Elita.
Hi, Juan. Good evening.
Hi, teacher.
Hi, hi, Veronica. How are you?
How are you?
Fine.
Fine, fine, thank you.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening, Alita.
Good evening.
Hi, Rosa Berta, how are you?
Fine, thank you.
Rosa, hello, Rosa.
Hello, Karina.
Long time no see you.
Yeah. Vividi dear colleagues.
Hello, Rosa.
Hi.
Hello, Rosita.
Hello, Julie. Oh, so happy. Thank you, Mr. Valenzuela.
I'm happy to see you, my dear friend.
Thank you for joining.
Yeah. Mr. Right. Valenzuela, you have changed your look.
Yes, it's my 2020 look. My 2020 look.
Looks so good.
Hi, Juan.
Hi.
How are you?
Fine, and you?
I'm fine too, thank you. You look happy tonight.
I am.
Hello, teacher.
Hello.
Hi.
All right, we are 38 people for the moment. And I think we can start right away. All right, are you ready to start? Yes, you can type your answers.
Yes, we are.
Okay,
good. Yes.
Yes, we can start.
All right, good. All right. So I'm going to share my presentation. All right, the first slide of my presentation. And tonight, since we are opening this program and we are opening a new teaching stage because of the critical situation we are facing right now worldwide, we are going to start with music, but with live music. Perhaps not all of you know about my music skills. I can sing, I can play the guitar, and tonight I will play a song for you on live. I haven't done this before, it is the first time, but I think that the situation is like appropriate for sharing something different tonight. And I'm happy to see you all virtually tonight. We've met many different times in different programs, through workshops, through teaching courses, but tonight is first time we are meeting here via Zoom. And this is why I wanted to start with music tonight. Also, before I show you the first slide of my presentation, I want to praise you all for being here and for having decided to be part of this webinar, which is going to allow us continue growing up professionally as teachers. And despite the difficult circumstances because of the COVID-19, we all are here and we all remain positive and optimistic. Why? Because we are teachers and we are like that. So we have a special gift, we have a different heart, we have a different mind, we have a different view on things. And I want to praise you all for being here. Tonight we are starting, as I said, with a song. It is an English song I like very much. And you don't know how much I've been rehearsing for tonight's presentation. Mm-hmm. I've been rehearsing all year, so I hope you really enjoy it. It is a song called Losing My Religion. Have you heard this song? Oh. Have you ever heard this song? Yes?
Yeah.
Yes.
I love it.
I have it.
All right. Okay. That means that most
yes,
of
REM.
You, most of you are in their 40s or 50s, maybe, right?
Not yet.
Yeah.
Right.
Your parents used to sing this song to you.
40.
When you were a little baby.
That's funny, teacher.
All right. Can you see the screen? Can you see the presentation I'm sharing?
Yeah.
Yes, I can.
Yeah.
Yes,
I'm going to display the lyrics so that you can sing with me. All right? So you can sing, you can clap, you can move. All right?
Right.
Can you hear the guitar?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, yes. It's okay.
Okay.
It's bigger
than you are not me.
Let's a time we go to the distance in your eyes.
Too much.
I said it out. That's me in the corner.
That's me in the spotlight.
Like losing my religion.
To keep with you.
And I don't know.
I've said too much. I haven't said enough.
I heard you laughing. I think I saw you try.
Every whisper of every word you see my confessions.
Trying to keep an eye on you like a horrible loss.
I said it, I thought that I heard you laughing, I thought that I heard you sing, I think I thought I saw you try.
That's me in the corner.
That I heard you laughing, I thought that I saw you try, that was just a dream.
Wow, it's gone.
Thank you.
Great, congratulations.
Claps for everyone. All right, good.
Perfect.
Oh, claps.
Good, good. Claps.
Claps, woo. Claps, all right. Okay, good.
It's very nice.
Can you all hear me well?
One more time.
Can you all hear me well? Yes?
Yes, teacher.
Okay, good. Now I want you all to mute your microphones, please. And just in case you want to intervene, just in case you want to say something, you can open your microphone, you can unmute the microphone, and then start to say what you need to say. All right?
I try it. I'm not a good singer, but I try it.
Okay, I want you to mute your microphones now, since we are going to start with the presentation. All right? Okay.
Okay.
Okay, good. You can use the chat bar also to type, to write, to communicate. All right, good. Okay. So welcome, everyone. Welcome again to our teaching program. This is our second program, which is called Effective Strategies and Techniques for Successful English Teaching and Learning. My name is Juan Valenzuela, and I am an English teacher. Tonight, we are going to share some strategies and techniques we can apply in our classes for delivering effective lessons. All right? And I want you all to participate. I want you all to feel familiar and feel ready to contribute. This is a chance we have to learn to learn from each other, all right? Because there is always something to say and something to hear. There are always new things we might say or we might hear and learn from other people. We are going to start with some riddles I've prepared for tonight's presentation. The first riddle goes like this. I'm tall, I'm sure. I'm tall when I'm young, and I'm sure when I'm old. What am I? What do you think this is? You can unmute your microphone and speak, or you can type your answer in the chat bar. What do you think it is? It is a riddle. It says that it is tall when it's young, but sure when it's old. Any ideas? What am I?
Human beings.
It is a candle, actually. Did you know this one? All right, the second one. I follow you all the time and copy your every move, but you can't touch me or catch me. What am I?
Shadow.
Yes, good. Your shadow, good, excellent. Good. Thanks, Julie. An easy one. The more of this there is, the less you see.
Light. The light.
Yeah, it's the opposite, actually, of light.
Dark, sorry.
Yes, darkness. So the more of this there is, the less you see, right? What has many keys but can't open a single lock? Any ideas? Many keys, but can't open a single lock.
The key holder.
No.
Piano?
Yes, good. A piano, yes, a piano has many keys.
A keyboard.
Yes, a piano or a keyboard, right? All right, good. Next. This is the last one. What has a head and a tail, but no body?
A worm?
Well, worms do have bodies. So it's not a worm. What is it? Any ideas? No?
No.
It's easy.
It starts with letter
C, with the letter C. A coin. It has head and tail, right? In Spanish, we say face and stamp, right? And when we play with coins to decide who goes first in a competition or in a game, we use coins, we throw coins, and in Spanish we say face and stamp, but in English we say heads and tails, right?
Right.
All right, good. Okay, that's enough for warming up and for preparing tonight's session, which is focused, as I said before, on effective strategies, on effective techniques we can apply in our classes for delivering effective lessons. Before we go through the presentation, I want to be clear about the things we will be covering tonight. So what will we talk about today? First, we are going to have an overview of the program you are participating in. Some of you are here because you already participated in this program last year, like Rosa Berta, right? Zoila, Jasmine, Eunice, you participated in the program last year. This year, we have this program again, and I'm giving you an overview of the program, so that you see how meaningful, how significant it can be for your classes, and how useful it is, or it'll be also for your own teaching. Also, we are going to talk about the current situation. You know, we are living a difficult situation. We are facing a difficult circumstance right now because of the COVID-19. And today we are going to cover some of this, since we, as I said before, the teachers are different people. And I know you are ready, most of us are ready, but there's always something else we can do, and we will go beyond. I will show you tonight, by covering this topic, how we can also improve our teaching by applying some of the techniques and strategies I told you we will share tonight. Also, we are going to revise, perhaps learn, or refresh some terminology that is related to English language teaching. And finally, we are going to cover a very important aspect of teaching, which is getting students to speak in English in the classroom, since it is a headache for many teachers, how to make students speak in English only without the necessity of having to use Spanish in the classes. All right, so I hope you find all of the things useful and helpful and interesting. Let's start then right away, okay? The first thing I said we would cover tonight is the overview of the program. The program we had last year and the program we are having again this year. Eunice, Jasmine, Rosa Berta, Zoila, I don't know who else is right there because I am seeing my screen only. What can you tell us about the program you took part in last year? Who wants to say something? What can you tell the new participants about this program?
Well, last year we learned a lot of things such as phonetic, grammar, methods, techniques, strategies, and so on. You can improve your English, yes, and be better.
Yes, thank you, Zoila. All right, thank you, thank you.
Okay.
It is true, as Zoila said, the program is focused on the typical things a teacher covers when teaching. We teach grammar, we teach pronunciation, this is we teach phonetics, but how much do we know about grammar? How good are we at grammar? How good are we at pronunciation, at phonetics, at vocabulary, right? Also, I said sometimes we have like headaches because we don't know how to plan our lessons in a way that they are significant and meaningful for our learners. And when I say learners, you see, it is a huge word. When I say learners, it can be a three-year-old, it can be a 17-year-old, it can be an adult of 45 years old. We never know the age of the students we are going to receive. Some of you are school teachers. Some of you are working in a language center or in a university. Some of you are only delivering private lessons. And right now, perhaps you are delivering online teaching. So I think the program and the things we will cover here have a lot to do with the work we do in our daily teaching. The program then is part of a training model for English teachers who wish to substantially improve the various strategies and effective techniques applicable in the teaching and learning process of English as a second language. The program is aimed at supporting both English teachers and university students of the last cycles of the foreign language degree with the necessary knowledge as well as the applicable strategies and techniques for delivering effective language lessons. So do you find this interesting? I want you to type in the chat bar, yes, no, maybe, a bit, or you can speak also. Do you find this interesting? All right, good, thank you, Eunice. Okay,
yeah.
Okay, good, thank you. Eunice is saying that she learned a lot about
yes.
different ways to teach last year. All right. Okay, she also remembers that we need to plan our lessons considering the different learning styles. Okay, very good. Thank you. Thank you, Dilcia. All right, good. The program is 14 weeks, the same as last year, and it is divided in two modules. After we finish the program, only if you want, you are going to receive a 225-hour certificate, which is issued after you complete the course. There are no entry requirements for this program, such as previous teaching experience or teaching or language qualifications, but I expect you all to have at least a pre-intermediate or between pre-intermediate and intermediate level of English, because this course, this program will be delivered in English only, 100% in English. You are going to be provided with supplementary material as extra help. You will work with an online platform so as to refine your teaching skills and your language skills. Soyla said that she felt that she didn't improve her teaching only, but also her English. So this is a great chance to share with other people, with other colleagues. I am sure that if you do your best, you can improve both your teaching and your language skills. Who wants to improve teaching skills? Give me a yes. Say me if you want to improve your teaching skills. Say me, who is saying me in the chat box?
Mr.
Okay, good.
And who would like to?
Yes, can you repeat that please?
I would like to share my experience last year with you in your training.
Okay, thank you, Rosa Berta.
Well, last year we had 4 months
mm-hmm.
on Saturdays.
Yes.
And it was really nice, and for me especially helped a lot because I had the opportunity to take EKT exam.
Mm-hmm.
And to apply my Mineto exam too, and I pass the exams, and I'm improving every day, and I would like to learn because we as teacher, we don't stop learning. We continue That's learning right. and we learn every day, and we learn help each other because yes. we as teachers need to support each one and each other.
Yes, thank you for your words. It is true. Last year, all participants learned a lot, including me, because every time I organize or I run a program, a course, I feel like one more participant because, as Rosa Berta said, you never stop learning. Actually, good teachers, the best teachers, never stop learning. So if someone asks me right now if I would like to improve my teaching skills, I would definitely say yes, because I am learning every day and I feel that I still need to learn more. Now my question is, would you like to improve your English at the same time? If you were given the chance to improve both your teaching skills, but also your English, your language skills, Would you like to take that chance? Yes or no? I want to hear you.
Yes.
Yes, right. Sonia, good, thank you. Veronica, all right, good. Catherine, yes. Me too. I want to improve my English. We are not native speakers. I am not a native speaker. And I feel I have progress with my English throughout the years. And every year I feel I progress a bit more, but I still need to improve my English because I am not a native speaker. I am a poor chalaco boy that is still learning and refining his language skills. So yes, both Karina, Claudia, it is important. If you take the program and you complete the program, we assure the quality of the lectures, the quality of the workshops, and the quality of the content you have in the platform, the parallel platform we have uploaded for you, the participants. We can assure the quality of all of these things through the trajectory of Abilities and Education, which is the organization, the institution I run. And this year, we count on the support of Editorial Norma, SBS Internacional, and again, with the support of the local office of the Ministry of Education, which is the Gerencia Regional de Educación Lambayeque. That's fantastic, because we are a group of people, a group of specialists, trying to offer the best for you, our colleagues, for you, the teachers of Peru. This is great for our communities, for the different communities. One of the advantages or one of the good things this year about having the program virtually is that we have participants from many different parts of Peru. We have people from Lima tonight, right? We have people from Cajamarca, we have people from Ancash, we have people from Arequipa also, we have people from Chiclayo, we have people from Tarapoto, and that's fantastic. Here, I want to make a pause to also tell you that having the support of all these people, the Editorial Norma, SBS Internacional, and the Gerencia Regional de Educación is fantastic for me. But mainly, I count on the support of my family, my wife and my son. They always support me with all my projects, with all I do, with all the teaching projects, the teaching issues I decide to be part of. And I want to thank them tonight publicly for all they give me and for all the support I receive from them. You know, it is Saturday evening and I'm here working, I'm here with you, and they always support me because number one, they know this is something I really love to do. And number two, they also see how positive it is for the community, the positive impact of having this type of projects and programs for not only for our local teachers, but this is national-wide receive, and this is fantastic for me. All right? Now, just to conclude, I want to let you know of what you will reach by taking the program, by completing the program. Throughout the program, you will be provided with different opportunities for improving both your teaching and your language skills. And you also will be provided with different strategies that will assist you in developing and delivering effective face-to-face teaching and online teaching, because I know that right now 100% of us are delivering online lessons. By the end of the program, you will be familiar with the main concepts and terms about teaching and learning that are central to English language teaching. This means you will be ready for taking TKT, for example, if you want, which is a teaching knowledge test offered by the University of Cambridge. And you will also be familiar with international standards for assessing students and for measuring progress. This is international evaluation standards for making sure we are including what we are supposed to when evaluating students.
Me he bañado, mamá.
All right. Please, your microphone. Yeah.
Ah, por lo que estaba poniendo la ropa por fuera.
Right. Had a shower today. Me too. That's good. It's our Saturday.
I also take a bath.
Turn off your microphone.
Our Saturday shower. All right, and by the end of the program, participants will be able to recognize different strategies and techniques for controlling discipline in the classroom. So as to become effective classroom managers. This is important. Also, you will be able to recognize and include effective ways of teaching English, both face-to-face and online, in a language lesson. You will be able to use different learning strategies, as well as develop and use appropriate teaching styles and methods for different types of learners. All right, that's all about the program. Now, I'm going to tell you what or who these webinars are for. All right? Who are these webinars for?
Well, first, if you are interested in improving both your teaching and language skills, again, then this webinar is for you. If you are interested in increasing your knowledge of teaching terminology and strategies, as well as applying this to your classes, then this webinar is for you, right? If you are interested in learning new ways of developing effective online teaching, then this webinar is for you too, right? However, if you want a totally theoretical exposition of teaching, then this webinar is not for you, all right? I will be talking from my experience, basically. I've been teaching English for 20 years, more or less. I started when I was very young. I was given a chance to work in a primary school near my house when I was 19 years old. How old, do you know how old I am right now? Or do you have any idea?
No.
No.
40.
Oh, yes, I'm 41. I am 41. However, I started teaching when I was 18, when I was 18 or 19. I started when I was very young. And throughout these years, I have learned many things, not only from my colleagues or from the places where I have worked, but mainly from my students. I have learned a lot from my students. And I've been doing this because, as I said before, this is something I love to do. So I will be learning with you, but also sharing all I have learned throughout these years. I have worked in many different schools, universities in Peru, in different parts of Peru. I have also had the chance to travel abroad and to have teaching experiences outside Peru. Before the quarantine was announced, before the 13th of March, I had planned a trip to Ecuador, to Guayaquil, for training teachers for an IB school. But you know, because of this situation we are living today, I could not travel. So all these things I have been doing these years is what I will be sharing with you, not only tonight, but throughout the different sessions we will be sharing this month. I told you that we were going to cover four things tonight. The first one was an overview of the program, which is something we already did. The second thing was the current situation. Today, everyone talks of this coronavirus. it is a difficult situation. It's difficult circumstances for many people. Many people have lost their relatives, their loved ones. And we are being informed of this every day. It is important that we are informed, but it is also important that we are positive about the situation, because we are teachers. And people expect from us optimism, enthusiasm. We cannot be negative. We have to transmit enthusiasm. We have to transmit positive energy everywhere. Before we start to cover this, I want you to tell me how much you know about this. I'm going to show you some statements, and you are, according to what you know, you are going to tell me if the statements you will read or you will see are true or false. All right? The first one says that the corona doesn't infect children. Is this true or false?
False.
It is false. So we have to take care of our children, right? Our future generations. It is false. Researchers state that children are not immune to the new COVID-19. And there have been thousands of cases of children being diagnosed with the disease. Children generally present with milder symptoms, but in some cases they can also be seriously affected. Or, what is worse, they can pass the virus on to others who are more susceptible or vulnerable. Right? Yes. Vulnerable. All right. Yes, Dilcia, even Minsa hides numbers. That's true. Hides numbers. And it's well known that more and more young people and children are becoming infected. Yes, Dilcia, thanks for your intervention. Thanks for your contribution. The second statement says, I'm pressing the buttons too fast. Ordering or buying products, like buying through Amazon or Wish, buying things that come from other countries, from overseas, will make a person sick. Is this true or false?
When you receive
the packages.
It's false.
It is false. Yes, it is false. Right?
Yes,
it's false. Yes, it is still being studied that the new coronavirus is telling us many new things every day. I have heard from many different people and many different times that this virus is new to humanity. So it's totally unknown, and it's like teaching us something new every day. So researchers are studying the new coronavirus to learn more about how it infects people. And the World Health Organization, which in Spanish is OMS, but in English is WHO, says that the probability, the likelihood or the probability of becoming infected likelihood of becoming infected with the COVID-19 from a commercial package is low. It's very low, very poor. So the probability is low, since it has likely traveled over several days and been exposed to different hands, to different temperatures and conditions during the trip or during transit. All right. Next. Once infected with the coronavirus, it can take 2 to 14 days to show symptoms.
True.
Is this true or false?
True.
So after exposure to the virus, symptoms have shown up as soon as 2 days to as long as 14 days later. The average incubation period is 5 days. So the incubation period refers to the time between catching the virus and beginning to have symptoms of the virus or of the illness. Hand sanitizer doesn't kill coronavirus because it's antibacterial, not antiviral. True or false? It's like some people are saying yes, some people are saying no. But what's the...
It's true.
The real thing.
True.
It's false, actually.
False?
Yes.
That's false.
Since hand sanitizer...
It's no antibacterial.
Antibacterial, all right. It is an antibacterial, yes, all right. But it is false since hand sanitizer with at least 60% of alcohol does kill the coronavirus. The alcohol disrupts the what? The deoxyribonucleic acid molecules in the virus. Do you know this word in Spanish? When I was a little boy, I like playing by saying like a tongue twister this word at the school. Ácido desoxirribonucleico. Ácido desoxirribonucleico. Can you say it as fast as me? Ácido desoxirribonucleico. And in English it is said deoxyribonucleic acid. All right? So the alcohol disrupts this, preventing it from making copies of itself. One good thing is that you can make your own hand sanitizer at home. Keep in mind that hand sanitizer is the second best way to keep your hands germ-free. The best way to keep your hands germ-free is washing your hands with soap and water. We have been advised to do this every 20 minutes, right? And especially after you go out or you, when you come back home after you had to do something outside, you have to wash your hands with soap and water for at least 20 seconds. All right, healthy people should practice social distancing. Is this true or false?
True.
I think it's true, sir.
True.
Yes, it is true. True.
It is true.
True, yes. Healthy people everywhere should practice social distancing to help flatten the curve. Vizcarra was talking about when the curve was going to be flattened, and we are still waiting, right? So if we want to flatten the curve, we have to practice social distancing. And some ways to practice social distancing are, number one, stay home. This includes not going to church, not going to the gym, not going anywhere. Don't travel for enjoyment until this has passed. And don't travel for work unless your work truly or really requires this. We need to be responsible, right? And avoid groups of people. Follow official guidelines given by your state or local authorities. All right. Yesterday I heard that the quarantine has been extended until the 31st of July. Have you heard this? That the quarantine has been extended until the 31st.
Yes.
Sure, but not exactly the quarantine, the emergency state.
All right.
I was.
Yes, Roberto.
Mm-hmm. Hello, sir. Good evening. So, good evening. I heard that in the news yesterday that quarantine, I don't know if it is going to continue. But the emergency state is going to continue until this July, until this July 31?
Yes, until the 31st of July. And as Carlos is writing, there are like some focuses, some specific communities or regions in which the quarantine will still be applied. Since you know, in some local governments are still struggling with the COVID-19. Lambayeque, for example, Callao, are some of the regions in which more people are being infected. So the not exactly the quarantine, but the emergency state has been extended until the 31st of July. One way of improving the situation right now is by following the guidelines given by the local authorities. All right. Okay.
Good. All right.
Okay. Another way to practice social distancing is when you must leave your home, for example, to get groceries or to go to work, you should maintain a distance of 6 feet away from people. Stay even farther away from people with a cough or who look sick. Yes, Maricielo, Lambayeque is not one of the regions keeping the quarantine. Yes, we are not following the orders here, the quarantine orders in Lambayeque and Irisat, right? When you do get groceries, buy twice as much as you normally do so that you can go to the store half as often. You don't go very frequently. Give me a second. I'm going to mute all the participants. Right? And just in case you want to say something, yes, you can unmute your microphone. All right? All right. Okay, it's done. All right, good. Okay, let's continue then. Thank you. Okay, I gave you the answer already. If you can hold your breath for 10 seconds, you don't have COVID-19. If you can hold your breath for 10 seconds, you don't have COVID-19. Yes? False.
No, false.
False, 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 false.
It's 20 seconds.
Yeah, that's false.
I think false, Sir John.
It's not 10, it's 20 seconds.
All right. Some people say 20, 30, a minute. All right.
More seconds.
All right. Okay, good. All right, good. So most young patients with coronavirus will be able to hold their breath for much longer than 10 seconds. Okay, you can mute your microphone. Okay, I'm going to mute the microphone. All right. Okay, good. Most young patients with coronavirus will be able to hold their breath for much longer than 10 seconds. Even many elderly people without the virus can't hold their breath for 10 seconds. So keep in mind there has also been some asymptomatic cases. An asymptomatic case is the case of a person that doesn't show the symptoms, right? So some people don't show any symptoms. These are the asymptomatic people. All right. Okay, so I've taken all this from these websites. All right. Dilsia is saying that concentrations of carbon dioxide will increase and it allows the virus to replicate. Yes, and that's sad. That's sad. But as I said, I've been saying, we have to remain positive. It is important to be informed and not to get stressed with this, right? Because this is stressful. This was so stressful, especially at the beginning. But we need to remain positive because we are teachers. What would be some positive things about the coronavirus pandemic? What would be some positive things? I want to hear you. I'm sharing a photo to share one of the positive things for me. Actually, there are many positive things the virus has brought. However, I will mention only three positive things in my presentation. Yes, we are valuing family right now, right? Yes, Dilcia, thank you. So one of the positive things is that family, we have family connection time. The photo, the first photo, the photo in which you see my son and my wife was taken this year on the 15th of May. That day was my birthday. I was 41 on the 15th of May. Wow. And tonight...
Happy birthday.
All right, thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, sir. Valenzuela, Mr. Valenzuela, happy birthday to you.
Oh, thanks. Wow.
Yeah. Yes, on 15 was a great lunch.
Yes, yes.
Okay, congratulations. Congratulations.
After the drinks.
Congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Happy birthday, my dear teacher.
After I'll take a present about to the different teachers of your family, Mr. Right. Now.
Thank you.
Have to thank him.
As you can see in the photo, there is evidence that there are no alcoholic drinks on my table. I was following the quarantine orders also.
Yeah, that's okay. You are reason.
To be honest, I haven't drunk a glass of alcohol since this started. And this is just a personal opinion, but I don't feel like celebrating right now. We have nothing to celebrate. Many people are dying. The situation in many homes is becoming very, very difficult. Many people don't have one penny, one sol, one cent to buy food, and they are desperate to go out for work. So in my opinion, there isn't much to celebrate. I haven't drunk alcohol since this started. And as you can see, one of the positive things, one of the things I could highlight about this new virus is family connection time. Tonight I started by singing. These months, these days, I have played my guitar more than ever. I am singing the Psalms with my wife every week, and we are uploading the Psalms in my YouTube channel every weekend. So this is one of the things I value from the coronavirus, family connection time. And I am sure many of you are doing the same. Many of you feel happy because you don't have to go to work. You have your children with you all day. I know that many of you have been working hard, and we had to wake up very, very early in the morning to prepare a quick breakfast. Sometimes we didn't even have breakfast because we had to run to work. We were in a hurry. We had to say a quick goodbye to our relatives. Then we came back home late, very tired, and we didn't have time to share with our loved ones, with our parents, with our brothers, sisters, with our children. So one positive thing is family connection time, especially the moms. And I tell you this because I see my wife. I know they are so happy to be with their children. My wife is saying that she wants to quit her job. She doesn't want to come back to work because she feels so happy to share time with our son. Can you believe it? So this is a positive thing. All right. Another positive thing I could mention is how beautiful our planet looks right now. This is news I got from the internet. For the ones who live in Lima, La Costa Verde is in Lima, and you know La Costa Verde, and you know how polluted it's always been, but how different it looks right now. And it's not only about Costa Verde, but how many of our reserves in Lambayeque, in Ancash, in Arequipa look differently right now. Because the planet is breathing pure air. So the earth is healing, and this is positive. Yes, the real predator is trapped now. Yes, Dilsey, I agree with you, right? So this is another positive thing. Another positive thing is that we can access different experiences. For example, we can access culture without having to travel. You can read books, you can download books, films from the internet, you can visit museums online. So there's no necessity to travel to become more knowledgeable about the world around us. So these are some of the positive things. All right, so we have covered the first two things we were supposed to cover tonight so far. The overview of the program and the current situation, which is the COVID-19. Now, we are going to move on to a new stage of tonight's webinar, which is classroom management. All right? I told you that I started teaching at the age of 18 or 19, when I was very young. And I told you I have worked in many different places in Peru, and also I have had the chance to experience teaching outside Peru. I have also been lucky enough to work with different groups, ages. I have taught preschool, I have taught primary, secondary, university, adults, business people. I have prepared people for international exams. And that's fantastic because that gives me the chance, number one, to challenge myself, because when I am given a new responsibility as an exam trainer, as a primary teacher, etc., I have to prepare. I have to investigate. I have to study. I have to make a plan. So number one, that's fantastic. So having all these experiences is fantastic because it's a challenge for me. And number two, because working with people with different styles, different ages, different necessities, different realities has expanded my vision on how teaching has to be delivered. And I have learned a lot in all these years. Tonight we are going to talk about classroom management. What does classroom management include? Can you see the photo right there? It's a photo that was taken 2 years ago in a kinder in Santa Victoria in Chiclayo. We had an afternoon program with these little kids. And it was so, so cool. The teacher on the right is a teacher from Chiclayo, Gabby, and she was the person in charge of this group. Right now I am not teaching kinder, but I like visiting classes, I like visiting different places for continuing teaching, for continuing doing what I like to do. So this is one of my visits, and I had a really good time with the children and with my teaching. What is classroom management? Classroom management then is about how you manage, how you administer what happens in the class. And it's really important for any teacher, especially for teaching children and teenagers in large classes. Here are some of the key things that you will need to start thinking about how to help your lessons go as smoothly as possible. All right. Are you familiar with these words? Are you familiar with these words? Eliciting, checking understanding, monitoring, organizing the learners. Yes, Carlos, thank you. Organizing the learners, more work. Dilcia, yes, organizing the classroom, giving instructions.
Yes.
Okay. Who does these things in class? The teacher or the students? Who does these things? Rosville, good. Carlos, Elada, good. Who does the things in the class? The teacher or the student?
Teacher.
Teacher.
Who is in charge of managing, of administrating the classes?
In the lesson planning?
The teacher or the students?
The teacher.
Teacher?
Yes. The teacher. Who has the most responsibility for the classes? The teacher or the student?
The teacher.
The teacher.
The teacher.
Teachers.
So whose fault is it if the class is a disaster? The teacher's fault or the student's fault?
Teacher.
Teacher.
Okay. Teacher. So there's
it depends on the teacher.
All right. Mainly, it is the teacher's fault. So there's no reason to blame the students for the result of the classes. It is our responsibility because we are the ones who are in charge of managing, of administrating. If you don't have the strength to manage a class, students will dance on you. Students will do whatever they want. And being able to manage a class effectively doesn't mean that we have to be serious, that we have to be strict. It doesn't mean that we have to yell at the students all the time. Being a good administrator doesn't mean that we have to write notes to the parents every time a student misbehaves.
Mira, si tú te das cuenta, 12 es como...
Right? But being a good manager is about having a strategy, about repeating routines, repeating behaviors. If we repeat behaviors, if we repeat techniques, we are going to have a successful classroom. All right. Eliciting. From the terms we had here, you have here, you can take a screenshot right now of this because we are going to use these words to complete some definitions. All right? Okay. You can take a screenshot right now or a photo of this because we are going to need these words to complete some definitions that come in the following slides. All right? This is deciding what you want to do with the chairs and desks in the class. Do you want your learners to sit in rows, in a horseshoe, cafe style seating around tables? What is this? One of the things we have seen previously is this. Which of these? Which of the things?
Organizing the learners.
The learners. Yes, we are organizing the learners here, but we are making a decision on how to
organizing the classroom.
Yes. In online teaching, because right now we are teaching online, how do you organize your platform settings? For example, this is organizing the classroom.
Yes.
Okay. So how will my classroom look? I need to decide how my classroom will be organized. Okay. This doesn't mean that I can ask my students what way they want to sit, for example, one day. This is for face-to-face teaching. And in online teaching, we can organize also the different settings of our platform to get the attention, to capture the attention of all the learners. Many teachers before the quarantine days, many teachers teaching in a school or in a language center, like to have like rows, and they are sitting down all the time in front of the students. So having rows only and being sitting down in front of the students doesn't help at all for having a successful class, for delivering effective lessons. The classroom has to be organized in a way that the teacher and the students have chances to communicate, have chances to participate. Today, for example, how did I organize my classroom? How did I organize my classroom today? I have organized this classroom, this platform. How did I organize it? I am administrating everything right now. How am I administrating my classroom right now? Can you notice the way I am doing things today? Am I giving you the chance to see the board? Can you all see my board?
Yeah, you are sharing.
Yes.
You are sharing.
You can see my board, right? Can you see me? Can you see me?
Yes, of course.
Yes. Can you see the presentation?
Of course.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. When someone speaks loudly, what do I do? Because we
you heard, say something.
I say something like what, Julie?
We took a shower to remember something.
Okay, yeah.
We repeat something. Mm-hmm. Or you try to say, oh, please turn off your microphone.
Yes, to organize my classroom in a way that my class, by the end of today's session or today's webinar, we all feel that the session was significant. when someone speaks louder, do I say, please turn off your microphone, be respectful, otherwise I'm going to put you out of the room? Do I say this?
No.
What is my reaction? What do I say? What did I do, for example, when I hear that someone had a shower?
You answered back that expression, the sentence. You just answered back. That was the reaction you had.
Okay. Who's that, Elisa? Elisa, is that you?
Yes, that's me.
I still remember your voice.
You are always polite, teacher.
Yes. So being polite is one of the main qualities of a successful teacher. All right? So if you want to be successful in your teaching, you have to be polite. So I don't stop sharing, I don't stop speaking, and I still let participants say things, because who makes the decision on how to organize the classroom? You, the teacher. You make that decision. You have to organize the class. Right now we have an online session in such a way that students have chances to communicate, to participate. I'm being polite. I have been teaching English, I told you, for more than 20 years. And being polite always works. Always works. Even with the most difficult learners, being polite always works. What is deciding how you want your learners to complete an activity? Organizing what? You said this before. Someone said this before, said the answer before.
Organizing the learners?
Yes, yes. In online teaching, how do you group students? Because you can group students also when you do online teaching.
Yes. Organizing the learners.
All right, so you make the decision on how students will work. Mm-hmm. And teaching online cannot be an excuse to say that the students cannot work in person.
Hello, Lisa.
Who's that, Julie? Can you listen to
me?
Can you all listen?
Yes.
Okay.
Good. Now everything is okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Julie, just in case you don't listen, perhaps it's your internet connection. You can wait, and if this persists, perhaps you can type in the chat bar and let me know to see if there's something I need to move right here. Okay?
Yeah, it's the internet connection, teacher, because right. I am in my mother's house. Thank you.
Okay, good. All right. Okay, as I was saying, you make the decision on how to organize the learners. And having online classes cannot be an excuse to say that we cannot group students or put the students in pairs or in trios or in groups. Because the platforms we work with today give us these chances to group students. Right now I am using Zoom, sometimes Meet, and sometimes Blackboard. I don't know what platforms you are using at the moment. Can you please tell me or type in the chat bar the platforms you are using right now for teaching? Zoom, okay, Ceci, thank you, Zoom.
Only Zoom.
Zoom, all right.
Google Meet?
Google Meet, all right. Cisco WebEx, that's a good one, yes.
Zoom teacher.
WhatsApp, yes, WhatsApp. Some teachers are using WhatsApp. Moodle.
Zoom, WhatsApp, Google Meet.
Yes. So all these platforms you are mentioning give us chances to group students. Not only for the live class, but also we can assign students some pair work or group work when they are home. All right, videos online, Zoom or Jetsy, good. All right, so we make the decision on how to organize the learners, organize the students. All right. The next one, the next term we are going to revise is, has to do with this, with asking students questions to find out what they know and what they don't know about an idea or about language. What's this? When you ask the students questions to see how much they know about a topic, about what you will cover, what's this? What do you call this? Any ideas?
Checking understanding.
Yes, good, Ceci. Eliciting. Eliciting.
Eliciting.
Yes. Eliciting. We do this in different ways. And we can do this at different stages of the lesson, not only at the beginning of the lesson, but in the middle of the lesson, by the end of the lesson, we can still continue eliciting. This is, we can ask students questions to see how much they know, how much they remember. Today I did eliciting, and I am still doing eliciting. In what parts of tonight's session have I done eliciting? Tell me, have you identified some parts of tonight's session in which I have done eliciting? Maybe at
the beginning of the class?
Yeah, what? What did I say? Tell me.
Some riddles?
Yes, we had the riddles and I was doing eliciting, all right?
Mm-hmm.
I was asking you to type in the chat bar, right? Or to say
about COVID
something. Yes, COVID. When we talk about the COVID-19.
COVID. Yes, mm-hmm. Collect information.
Yes, I was collecting COVID. Information. Yes, and I am still doing this. So as I said before, we elicit all the time, not only at the beginning of a session, but also in the middle of a session, by the end of a session. So we are going to continue revising this terminology since these are things we need to be familiar with. Why? Because we are the teachers, all right? And right now, maybe you don't have the printed versions of the teacher's books with you in your hands, because we cannot access a library right now. But perhaps you are consulting reference resources on the internet. And sometimes the information we find has this terminology, like first you elicit, then you check understanding, then you do board work, etc. We have to be familiar with this. And after the completion of the program, after all the things we have learned, if you want, if you feel ready, you can take an international exam that is related to teaching knowledge, like Cambridge TKT, for example. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, what is telling learners what you want them to do in an activity?
Telling learners what you want them to do.
From the words
giving instructions?
Previously showed. Yes, yes, yes.
Giving instructions.
Yes. As you can see, we do all the things, or we are supposed to do the things in our classes. We are supposed to organize the classroom, to organize the learners, to elicit, to give instructions. It is important to be good at giving instructions. The language you will use for giving instructions will depend on the level of your students.
Okay.
All right? If you are teaching a beginner's class, open your book, page 20 is enough. But if you are teaching an intermediate class or an advanced class, an instruction could be, could you please open your books and check the second exercise of the first section on page 20? And after you give an instruction, you have to make sure everyone understands your instruction. When teaching children, for example, it is important to make the children repeat what you said to make sure everyone understood your instruction. Otherwise, if you just ask students, do you understand? Everyone is going to say, yes, yes, yes. Can you see my face? Students, did you understand? ¿Qué dijo? Right? The best way to check your instructions were given successfully is by asking students to repeat what you said. Okay? Today, for example, we are going to cover the program overview, the current situation, ELT terminology, and how to make students speak in English. We are covering four topics, all right? How many topics are we covering tonight? Can you please tell me? How many topics are we covering?
Four.
Okay. After the session, I want you all to type one thing you learned tonight. After we finish the session, you have to type one thing you learned tonight. Okay? Okay, what are we going to do tonight when we finish the session?
We're going to write something about what we learned during the session.
Yes. Yes, good, Julie, thank you. How many things do we have to write? How many things?
Just one.
Just one, okay? So after we finish the session, you have to write one thing you learned tonight. So you see the way we can do it, the way we deliver an instruction and then we make sure the instruction was understood. All right?
Yes.
In the following slides, we will see that it is not necessary to translate instructions. It is not necessary to say one instruction in English and then say it in Spanish to make sure that the students understood. Because our job is not to make students understand Spanish, but our job is to make students understand what? What language?
English.
English. All right? So when giving instructions, avoid the use of Spanish. Be clear, be concise. Use the appropriate amount of language depending on your student's level. Beginners, for example, open your book, page 10. That's enough. And make sure your students understand what they are expected to do. This way you will avoid like a million questions after your instruction, like, Miss, para hoy, Miss, con rojo, con azul, Miss, que se manda la tarea, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All right? Okay, good. Next. This is checking instructions, all right? What I said, to ask the students questions to check that they understand the meaning of the language you use or to check that they know what to do in an activity. Organizing your board and using the board to help learners learn. What is this called? What is the terminology for this?
Board work.
Yes, good.
Board work.
Soila, yes, board work. So you need to organize your board. In face-to-face teaching, you have to be organized when using the board. Perhaps you don't have the best handwriting of the word, or you don't have the best drawings of the word, but your board has to look organized. Some teachers are experts at confusing students with the board explanations. Because they put so many things on the board that instead of making students understand, they confuse the students completely. So it is important to organize the board in a way that it helps the students to learn. For example, in one corner of your board, not only your face-to-face board, but also your online board, because Zoom has a board, right? Or whatever platform you are using, you have a board available. One corner of your board can be used, for example, only for vocabulary. Another corner of your board can be used for making drawings of the words you want the students to learn. Another corner of the board can be used for writing definitions or for doing pronunciation, etc. I told you like a few minutes ago that strategies and techniques is about repeating things in our teaching, repeating routines in our teaching. If we become good at repeating these things politely, enthusiastically, we are going to assure effective teaching. So being good at or using the board is something we have to do every week. So if you are going to use the board, use it appropriately and use it frequently, so that it is one more tool for making your students learn the language. Okay, this is when learners are doing an activity on their own or in pairs or groups, and the teacher walks around the room to look at or listen to what they are doing, to check that they are doing the right thing and to help when needed. In online teaching, this is when the teacher makes sure that the students are doing what expected. What is this?
Monitoring.
Yes, monitoring. All right? We need to monitor. It's not about, in face-to-face teaching, it's not about saying, okay, complete pages 20, 21, 23, and 24, and then you sit down to finish your delicious sandwich. You need to monitor. You assign work to the students, you need to monitor. In face-to-face teaching, this is, you need to walk around the classroom to make sure students are doing what they are supposed to be doing. And in online teaching, it's not about saying, okay, students, do this, and then turn off your camera and go to see your soap opera for 5 minutes because tonight is the final episode. So monitoring is about being behind the students, because all we have done has a purpose. And if we don't do this part of the process, which is monitoring, we are not going to assure learning. Because when you assign students a task, they have many questions inside. So this is the chance they have to ask you and the chance you have to be near them and see both their strengths and weaknesses. Some students need more help with speaking, some others need more help with grammar. So when you monitor your classes, you see what each student, what each specific and unique learner needs, and you are able to help them in an appropriate way.
Teacher, how do you monitor an online class?
Mm-hmm. I monitor an online class when I ask my students, I tell them, okay, you are going to do this and you have 5 minutes, all right? In minute 1.5 or in minute 2, I start to say, okay, how much have you done? Do you have any questions? Do you understand this part? In this part, what have you put? Okay, Have you finished yet? Okay, let me know if you need something. I will be here. This is the way I monitor my online classes, and this works.
Okay, thank you.
I hear students asking me, teacher, when I assign something, a short task or a long task, they ask me, teacher, but the other day you said this. Because they see something we are covering, and the other day you said this, and I am there. It's not that I give you some work, and I turn off my camera, and I take advantage of this like free time to do some other things. Because we are doing remote work right now. We are working from home. But imagine you are in your classroom. Imagine you are in your school, in your language center. When you are in the language center, in the school, you say, okay, you have 5 minutes, and then you stand up, you go to the bathroom, you take your phone, you check messages. Do you do this when you are at the school, when you are at the language center? Teachers, do you do this? No.
No, definitely no.
How would you feel if you were studying on a face-to-face class and your teacher tells you, okay, you have 5 minutes, and the teacher starts to check messages, to eat something, to stand up, to the teacher goes to the toilet. How would you feel in your class? How would you feel in a class like that? Tell me.
Bored.
Bored. What else? Tell me other words. Tell me other adjectives.
Frustrated.
Yes, I would feel frustrated too, bored. I would feel like surprised, like what? Is this a teacher?
Upset.
Upset, right?
Yes.
All right. So monitoring is very important. Now, what did you say?
For example, if as you are calling Julie, what do you think? Or Carlos or Rosita, what do you think? And the students need to be very concentrated to participate.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. They need to. Yes. And if you are monitoring constantly, your class is going to run like smoothly. It's going to be a dynamic class. But if you don't monitor, everyone will be doing nothing. So as you said, Julie, if the teacher is constantly saying, okay, have you finished yet? Have you done this? Okay. In what part of the text are you right now? The students will be attentive because the teacher is going to be asking and asking. Am I monitoring right now? Have you seen me monitoring since this began until now? Have you seen me monitoring?
Yes, teacher, because even if we write in the chat, you are attentive.
Yes, I am attentive. Yes, I am attentive, and I am also asking frequently, are you there? Did you hear? What do you say? Yes or no? Okay?
Tell me if you have a problem.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you see the answer? Do you see the question? Do you understand? Right. This is a way to monitor, and we have to be constantly monitoring. Okay. Telling learners how they are doing. This could be checking the answers to an activity in class or providing some correction. It could also be talking to learners about their progress. What is this?
Checking understanding.
Also, we
checking understanding.
Feedback.
Feedback, yes. And Sonia wrote that, Sonia Wankas.
Using feedback.
Monitoring will enable us to give regular feedback. Yes. So if you monitor, you will be able to give feedback. But if you don't monitor, how can you give feedback to a student to say, no, this is good, this is bad, if you were never present, if you were absent all the time? So this is to give feedback. This is giving feedback. Do you give students feedback? How often should we give our students feedback?
In the class.
During the class, yes, all the time, all yes. The time. And also when the class has finished, we can give the students feedback.
Yes.
Many of you have been in one of my courses. For example, Roberto, you prepare for FCE with me. Roberto Lera, right? Carlos Piñin, you prepare for TKT with me, right? Pedro, Vladimir Solano, Rosa Berta, you also prepare for TKT. Sorry if I don't remember all the names. How have you felt when after a class, I send you a WhatsApp message, a text message, telling you something positive about your progress? How did you feel?
Great.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Zoila. Roberto? Rosa Berta? Pedro?
Hi. Happy.
Happy, right? So, students will react positively to the feedback you give them, depending on the way you give feedback. And we have to be given feedback all the time. Yes, we have to be enthusiastic, Sonia, thank you. We can also use some elements to verify if they are paying attention. Yes, Dilcia, right? So we have to be polite all the time, especially when giving feedback. And giving feedback means being concise, being clear, and being honest. You cannot tell a student all the time, well done, good job, perfect, if the student doesn't really deserve this. This is not honest feedback.
Something important, Mr. and colleagues, is that the errors or mistakes are part of our learning and our students' learning.
Yes, yes. So it's good to see errors this way. Thank you, Rosa Berta. It's good to see errors or mistakes as natural part of learning. Who doesn't learn from their mistakes? In general, in life, we learn from our mistakes, or no?
Yes.
So errors, mistakes,
yes, of course, are
very important in the learning process. Now we are going to focus on how to make students speak in English. Now I want you to speak or type your answers in the chat bar. You have to type your answer or speak, okay? This is about speaking in your classes. Mm-hmm. Number one, how often do you use Spanish in your lessons? Be honest. Oh, Roxana, it's a pity you have to leave. All right, please type your answers or say something. How often do you use Spanish in your lessons? You're welcome, Roxana. Okay.
Occasionally.
Some of you are typing often, okay. Okay, Dilcia, hardly ever, all right. Sometimes, often, all right. Often, okay.
Sometimes.
Mm-hmm. How much Spanish do you consider a teacher could use in class? Like 0%, 20 to 40%, 30 to 50? How much Spanish do you consider a teacher can use in class or could use in class?
20 to 40.
Right. And the rest, what do you say? 20, okay, Miriam. Thank you, Miriam. Quispe. How much is
20?
Consider 20 to 40, Flor. Okay, good. Marisabel, 20.
20 to 40.
Aha, okay. Okay, 20 to 40, okay. It seems to be that you like that number, all right? Everybody likes this number. 20 to 40 is the favorite number today. Okay.
20 is my grade.
All right. Okay, before we go to the following question, how much Spanish have I used today? 0, 20 to 40, 30 to 50. How much Spanish have I used today?
0%.
Uh-huh. Zero.
Right. 0%.
Woo! I did it.
Good teacher.
All right. Okay, now. What do you do when a student is speaking Spanish in your classes? You cry when students speak in Spanish? You explain to students how important English is? You get angry? Or you just continue speaking in English? You
we explain how important English is.
All right, okay.
All right. Explain how important English
okay,
is.
Okay, okay. So you don't cry?
No.
No, no cry.
Not even when you watch Mexican movies?
Oh, your teacher.
All right.
I love my onions. Don't cry.
Okay, good. Okay, Pedro, thank you. You repeat what they said in English, okay? You continue speaking in English.
Yes.
Good. Okay, good. Elisa, you help them to speak correctly. Do you feel frustrated when your students are speaking Spanish to you? Yes, no, or you don't care?
No. No.
Not frustrated, but we try to explain that they must use English.
Dilcia says she has a blacklist. If a student is speaking. Okay. Yeah, lots of, okay. Okay, good. Dilcia, when I teach kids, I use points on the board. And every time they speak Spanish, it's like I raise them points to the groups I form.
Yeah, exactly like this.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And if they are using Spanish, it's because they have a lack of vocabulary, lack of grammar, lack of something. So they need more input. So we have to give them lots of input.
All right. Thank you. Okay, good. Okay, Angela Correa, thank you. You translate to English. Good. All right. Now, why do you think students don't speak in English? Well, the number one thing is fear. Some years ago, I read in a survey that the number one fear is not death for people in the world. I thought, before I read this article, I thought that the number one fear for humans was death, but it's not like that. You know what's the number one fear? To speak in public. And the number two is death. So the main reason why students don't speak in English in class is fear. Fear of what? Of being criticized, of being overcorrected or ridiculed by the teacher or other students.
This bullying, is
bad,
bullying.
But true, yes, bullying. Also, another reason is lack of knowledge of the language. Sometimes they want to speak, but they don't have the vocabulary to speak. Right? So as Tilcia said, they need lots of input before they can produce output. And the input must be meaningful, significant, clear, concise, and in context. They have lack of knowledge of the language. So students need to hear English many times before they will be confident enough to produce English in any quantity.
Mm-hmm.
There is also another reason, which is lack of motivation and encouragement. This is lack of understanding of the importance of production in the learning process, because many learners may think that they can learn a language passively, just by listening, especially people from our generation, and they are afraid of speaking. Here are some strategies that work. Do you want me to share these strategies? We have 7 minutes. Remaining. Number one, speaking English 100% of the time, inside and outside the classroom. Because you the teacher, me the teacher, we the teachers have to set the example. So there is no real reason for using Spanish language one, no matter what some teachers claim. It's useful, but not necessary. How much Spanish did I use tonight? How much Spanish did I use tonight? Tell me.
0%.
Zero Spanish tonight. And maybe not everyone in this room has the best English in the world, but I am using gestures, I am showing sentences, I am using pictures, I am giving examples, cases, so that you all can follow me, can understand, not every word, but the message or the heart of my message. The heart of my message. So don't try to make students understand every single word you say, but make sure students understand your messages. Classroom management can be introduced right from the start and added to every lesson. Classroom management means, can I do this? Can I do that? Can I stand up? Teacher, sorry, my battery is low. You have to teach these things to the students so that they can use this and communicate these simple things in your classes, both in face-to-face teaching and in online teaching. You have to teach students this so that they can communicate. They can tell you, me, sorry, my little brother is crying. Okay, give me 1 minute. I will connect again in 1 minute. So from the very beginning, we have to teach these things to the students. When we had face-to-face teaching, we thought, may I go to the bathroom? Can you lend me your pen? Now that we teach online, we have to teach other language to the students, like, teacher, sorry, my little brother is crying. Teacher, sorry, my mom is calling me. Teacher, sorry, how can I present my board? Teacher, sorry, how do I share my screen? Teacher, sorry, how do I access the website? We have to teach these things to the students from the very beginning so that they can communicate in English with us. Is this clear? Is this clear?
Yes, it is.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Write on the board. Use the board you have. If you're doing online teaching, you have a board. When you go back to face-to-face teaching, use your board. Use your board to make students understand what you are saying. But don't speak Spanish, please. There's no necessity to speak Spanish. And use mime gesture to help students understand what you are saying. Ask the students to translate your management language. Don't do it for them. English only has to begin on day one at level one. This is a second strategy. So the first English teacher in the system has the most responsibility. She or he establishes the norms and expectations of English language teaching and learning. If the first teachers, the kindergarten teachers, use Spanish frequently, the students will become addicted to Spanish, and it will be very difficult to break the habit. All right?
Yes.
If you inherit or you receive a group of students who are addicted to language one, to Spanish, it is still possible to change their perception and attitude. It is possible also that you face resistance, but you can change the situation. And use English to socialize with the students at the beginning and end of the lessons. Motivate your students. Please inspire your students to use English. And they will only use English if they listen to you speaking in English all the time. Who's the most important factor in the English language teaching and learning process? You. You are the most important factor. The most important factor is not the computer, not the course book, nor anything else that has the power to motivate or demotivate the students. You have the power to motivate the students. You also have the principles and techniques which can motivate your students to use English. And keep in mind that if you correct the students every time they speak, you are going to kill motivation, to kill confidence. Okay? So if they make mistakes, just ignore the mistakes. If you speak to them in English and they respond to you in Spanish, continue speaking in English. As Pedro said, You can repeat what they said in Spanish in English and continue. But don't get angry. Don't feel frustrated. Don't say, please, I have explained this many times and English is important. You have to speak in English to me. No. All right? Smile, smile, smile. In face-to-face teaching, this doesn't help at all. So avoid horizontal and vertical single rows because this creates barriers. Not this. This gives the students the impression that language learning is an individual activity that does not require communication and interaction. This classroom looks much better. And in face-to-face or in online teaching, give students chances to participate. Nominate students instead of asking for volunteers. Nominate students, say, you, Julie, you, Roberto, you, Rosa Berta, please. Call students by their names. Ask them to type in the chat bar and to reinforce grammar, vocabulary, and pronunciation naturally, optimistically. Make the students feel that their contributions are relevant, because if you make them feel that what they say is relevant, they will feel like they want to participate again next time. Make the students feel you are there and you are listening to them. Yes, empty classrooms, Roseville, right now. Create an atmosphere of mutual respect and support. Outside the classroom, continue communicating with the students in English. We have WhatsApp right now, which is a fantastic tool. If you write an email to a student, do it in English. If you write a WhatsApp message, if you say hello on Facebook, do it in English. If students see their teachers using English, it will have a profoundly positive effect on their perception of the language, on their own attitude to learning English, and on their motivation. If you are not used to doing this, you can start to introduce this slowly. For example, you can agree to speak only in English to each other on Wednesdays, for example, and then you include one more day, etc. How many hours do students need to acknowledge English effectively? More or less 324 hours. And that's more or less the number of hours a student gets before the pre-intermediate phase. All right. So even if you have 1.5 hours of English a week, your students will be able to acquire the language in 4 to 5 years. Obviously, if you speak in English only all the time, every single day and in every single lesson. All right, now I want you all to type in the chat bar one thing you learned today. Please, everyone, I want you all to type in the chat bar one thing or two or three you learned today. Thank you, Elisa. Managing an online classroom. Please, I want you all to say something. Type one thing you learned today. Yes, music. Yes, we started with music. Terminology, ELT terminology, vocabulary. Yes, I am sure you learned new vocabulary today. And one of I did with the intention, the coronavirus part, with the intention of learning new vocabulary. Okay, managing terminology, how important it is to be a great motivator. Thank you, Dilcia. Good. What else? Tell me. I want you all
be polite to... Yes, be polite all the time, yes, with
yes, the students. Yes, the importance of being polite. All right, we learned also about the terrible coronavirus pandemic. Okay, Carlos, thank you. Carlos Celada, terminology. Ceci. Come read. Sonia, Cecilia. Yes. Thank you, Zoila. Thank you too.
Family connection time.
All right. Yes, connection time, which is important. Yes, Maricielo.
Music.
Yes. Good, Maricielo. Olivia, good. Music, yes, thank you. Jasmine, Olivia, thank you. Olivia, speak in English, all the class don't translate. Good, yes. Jasmine, terminology, how to motivate. Giovanna, we are the most important factor in the learning process. Yes, we are, good. Maria Leiva, how important it is to organize the class. Yes, for motivating a student. Speaking in English all the time, Luzmila. Good, 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 excellent. Thank you all. Carlos Chavez, Catherine. Good, wow, I am sure we have learned many things. I have learned a lot also from you. All right. Now it is time to say goodbye. The session
bye-bye,
has come. I want you all to activate your
teacher.
So your camera. Bye-bye, your camera so that I can take a screenshot.
Yeah.
Yes. Your cameras.
To look at different faces.
Yes, my 2020 look.
From different parts of
the look, not problem. The problem is the knowledge.
All right, yeah, that's true. All right. Can you please turn on your cameras? Sonia, Juancas, Karen, Pimentel, Dilcia, Tania, Veronica, Zoila.
Sorry, teacher, I don't have camera.
Okay, that's okay, no problem. All right.
Bye-bye, all right. Teacher.
All right.
Bye-bye, teacher, don't bye, forget. Teacher.
That would be all for bye. Today then.
Goodbye.
Bye, bye.
Goodbye, bye, everyone.
Nice weekend.
Teacher.
Bye.
Happy birthday.
Bye.
Bye. I love your car, Carlos Celada. Thank you. Bye.
Carlos Enriquez, too.
Yes. No? Yes.
Mm-hmm. What do I say?
Ceci, my friend, send my regards to your mom.
Bye, teacher.
Bye. Bye.
Bye, Pedro.
Take care.
Bye, teacher.
Bye,
Carlos. Take care, too. Bye-bye.
Bye, teacher.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, teacher.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Take care. Bye-bye. You're welcome.
Ya no, ya.
Cumpa. Right.
Ya. ¿Está bien? ¿Me escuchas?
Sí. Okay, bye bye everyone.
Bye bye. Okay.